century. A scientist saw a killer comet on its way. He filmed instructions for its destruction over a second-hand VHS tape. But then was hit by a Winnebago. So his assistants Nick and Joe must search every corner of his drone for a cassette that is on the home. But in the meantime, they'll play the greatest clips they found.
VCR, party live. VCR, party live.
Lana Melendez.
Well, hello, Melendez.
Hi, Melendez.
It's Tuesday night. Yeah, it's time for VCR party. This is the show from the Found Footage Festival, guys. That's me and Joe. And our director, Steve, and our VHS detective, George. And this is where we watch a bunch of VHS clips from tapes that are usually, well, they're kind of sequestered in our office that we can't get to. So we're going off.
They're covered in coronavirus right now. All of our VHS is covered in it. And so we can't go in. So we have to make do with the shit that we got laying around here, like tons of DVDs.
And I got this one that I'm excited to show, just what the cover is. I'm not going to give it away right now. And we like to start with a Found Footage Festival classic first. What do we got today?
Well, let's roll a graphic.
You caught me with my pants down, but no one sells carpet or waterbeds for less.
Today we have, this is probably the one of the top three classics of all time for Found Footage Festival, Kirk's 40th birthday, May 1992. And this is like an annual tradition here on VCR Party. Every May, at some point during May, we don't know what the exact date is of Kirk's birthday, but we have to play this video. So this is the home movie that our buddy Nate found in a Salvation Army in Marshfield, Wisconsin. Kirk's 40th birthday, May 1992.
We got Bob's birthday present, so
uh-huh. Yeah, payback time, huh, buddy?
Recording?
Yeah. Oh, yeah, man. Hey guys, how the fuck you doing, man, over there? Close in. All right, oh, a little bit closer, look, we gotta make it work like it's worthwhile, you know?
So many quotable lines.
Say something to your dad.
Hey, brother, how you doing?
Get out of here!
Okay, don't do that, dude.
So you can go all the way back.
That's what I was just doing now.
Like this? There, now look at me.
Hi, Mom. There goes Kirk on his birthday, pushing his scooter, finally got the fucker running.
You gave that shit a 2x4.
How you turn this thing off, Bob?
My thumb ain't that long.
Ooh, it's windy out. Excuse me.
All right, so we'll end it there.
Excuse me. Seems like a logical out point for that one. So, you know, some people have, like, gone through and they figured out what the good day was from the Ice Cube song, you know, they've used all the details. So maybe someone could watch the Kirk's tape and triangulate what the exact day in 1992 that was.
Well, we did do the EP mode where we watched the entire thing. And I think that there were, also we wanted to know where he was from. We assumed Wisconsin because it was found in Wisconsin.
Yeah.
But there's no guarantee. It doesn't, I mean, it kind of sounds like a Wisconsin accent. But anyway, go back. If you're a patron, go back to the Kirk's 40th birthday and watch the entire thing with Nick and I. And there's so many clues in there, but we didn't pick up on any. So
yeah,
we're watching it on a small screen too.
We should really, it feels wrong to just celebrate during the month. We would love to know the exact day and then celebrate that every year. But regardless, that's Kirk's 40th birthday,
May 1992. While I was looking for that, I found a piece that you had put together of the Kirk's end references. So the end of the video, it ends this way. Let me just share this. This is how Kirk's 40th birthday ends.
When you're cool, the sun shines on you 24 hours a day, man. That's why I wear these shades.
I'll be back.
I feel so lonely, and I know I'm not the only one.
So there's a bunch of pop culture references in there, and we didn't know any of them.
I mean, we knew I'll be back. We knew everybody knows that one. Yeah.
There were three. There were three in the like last 15 seconds of Kirk's 40th birthday. We knew one, and then you tracked down the other two, and here they are.
Everybody's cool.
Why do you wear sunglasses at night?
Because when you're cool, the sun shines on you 24 hours a day.
I'll be back. I feel so lonely and I
know I'm not the only one. Who is this? Is that Tesla?
Yeah, I think so. And the movie was, what movie was that?
I have no idea.
I had it.
I'm going to say 3 o'clock high. I don't know.
Yeah, something like that. I forgot. I looked it all this up when I was putting that together.
Uh-huh. My science project.
Yes, that's what it was. My science project. Thank you, George. I knew it was something like that.
George, you didn't know that off the top of your head, did you?
I have Google.
Okay.
Yes.
Type in, what was your search?
Shines on you 24 hours.
I got it.
Yep.
Oh, the internet.
Yeah.
Too cool. Oh, so hey, I want to start a new weekly segment here. Steve's Weekly Weigh-In. You know, last week we spent a lot of time talking about Steve's weight. How is it this week, Steve? You up or are you down? I can't hear you. I can't hear you. Can you hear him?
No.
He's muted.
Nope.
Still muted. This is really important, Steve.
Steve, we need to know your weight. All right, Steve. While you futz with that, here's
there it is.
Oh, there you go.
Sorry.
Okay. You're up or are you down?
I am down.
Okay. So I texted you yesterday. I asked you what your current weight is. You said 235, and I had an idea for inspiration. I'll look up IMGs at your current weight, and this will inspire you. Then I looked at the weight that you wanted, that you should be at, like let's say 215,
sure,
for inspiration. So let's take a look first at 235.
Let's explain that these are, if you type in YouTube IMG and then a 4-digit sequence, you find accidentally or automatically uploaded videos that have zero to, you know, none of these have more than 100 views, I don't think. So
no, most of them have like 6 or 7 views.
Yeah.
So yeah, people just accidentally uploaded these, or their cameras automatically uploaded them. Steve, here's for you. Now watch this. This is IMG 235, which is your current weight, okay?
Para el tercer ciclo va a empezar con 3 rollos de papel apilados de esta manera. Lo que tenéis que hacer es, a pies juntos, saltar los 3 rollos. De esta manera habréis conseguido una moneda de oro que la tenéis que colocar en vuestra camiseta.
Okay, Steve, so that was 235.
Okay.
That's right. Is that supposed to be impressive that she's jumping over the toilet paper, or?
Well, the video, she adds another one after that, and another one after that, another one after that.
I would have just skipped till she had 4. I mean, like the two is just not.
Well, he has to start somewhere.
Yeah. Exactly.
That's true. Okay, good point.
I'm going to add this to my workout routine.
It's not exactly easy for Steve to get around. He weighs 235. So Steve, so that was 235. Here's 215, IMG 215. Which, you know, is probably what you're targeting, right? 20 pounds less.
Yeah, I'd love to.
You
know,
this could be you.
Para conseguir.
215. Cool. Steve.
That's what you would look like at 215.
All right. I mean, I've never been more motivated. This is great, Joe. Thank you.
Yeah, no problem.
Wow.
So we'll do a weekly weigh-in each week. I'll show you a new IMG for whatever your weight is.
And whether it's up or down.
Yep. Is there a graphic or no?
No, but we need, you want to work on one, George? Do you have an idea? You got a vision?
No. I just feel bad for Steve.
I do too.
I think that's the most common feedback, is we want more updates about Steve's weight. So I'm glad this is a regular thing. The other thing that we've been mentioning a lot lately is our tour for Volume 9 of the Found Footage Festival got canceled back in March, and we've been trying to rebook shows, but who knows what the future is going to be for venues. So in the meantime, we're going to be doing our first live show where you pay admission to come see it, and it's going to be over Zoom. We're calling it Found Footage Festival's Big Bad Webinar, because the Zoom thing that you use for insists on calling it a webinar, but it's gonna
the worst
be,
word. It's one of the worst words in the English language.
Yeah,
does it count as a word? I don't know if it counts as a word.
I mean, just call it an online seminar. I would prefer that than the shorter webinar.
Webinar doesn't even sound like seminar.
No.
Like seminar, webinar.
It's a
stretch.
I'll say this. My dad only calls them Webamars.
Webamars?
Yeah, which doesn't make any sense. But I try to correct him. It's been going on for several years now.
Maybe we should change it to Found Footage Festival's Big Bag Webamar so your dad will be able to tune in.
Great. That means I spend 8 hours trying to get him connected to it.
Well, so as of tonight, immediately after the show, if you go to foundfootagefest.com, there's a link to sign up for it. We're only allowing 100 attendees to our very first webinar.
Why are we
doing
that? Why are we restricting it to 100?
Because you have to pay $100 more to get it up to 500.
And there we go.
That's too big of a risk for a first online webinar. So
Webamar.
So we're going to try this out. We have perhaps the biggest special guest in the history of the Found Footage Festival. Plus,
You're underselling
it. I mean, you remember when all the celebrities have been using Zoom to do Imagine, or the state did Porcupine Racetrack? They got together who else? I don't know. Everybody's been doing the Goonies did a reunion. This show is going to be bigger than all of those because of the guests we have lined up. I can't give too much away, but this is going to be huge. So go to foundfootagefest.com, sign up, and we'll see you there. There's going to be interactive game shows, and you can chat live during the webinar and the webinar. So it's June 12th. We'll see you
June
then.
June 12th. Yep. Friday night. It's going to be fun. Hey, let's get into some Dead of the Duns.
That's it. Dead of the Dun. Right there.
All right. It's time for viewer mail. And we got two of them. But one of them we don't have access to. One of them is back in the office, so we can't do it. So this one comes from Andrew. Andrew asked for more Stairway to Stardom. He said, I've always been a big fan of the few Stairway to Stardom clips I've seen. Can we see some more, maybe some you've never aired? And then he said, or we could see some classics. So I did a little bit of both. Here's a brand new one you've never seen from Stairway to Stardom. And then after that, it's going to be a classic in its entirety.
This is a public access show that ran for almost 30 years in Manhattan. It just featured amateur singers and dancers and the whole gamut.
Uh-huh. All right, here we go.
About this guy.
She came down from Mars. This creature from space.
I would have framed him out of the shot if he's
with luminous eyes.
I told him, grab a coffee or something.
And glittering face. She approached the wall. Oh, what a disgrace.
Drums happening in the song.
Yeah, not by him.
You light up my life. You give me hope to carry on. You light up my days and fill my nights with song. It can't be wrong.
You think YouTube's algorithm will recognize
when
this?
It seems so right.
Yeah, we're getting taken down. There it is. Yeah.
Wow.
So Stairway to Stardom.
Good to see some of the deep cut classics from that. I was thinking that for our EP mode episode, the one for our patrons at the $10 and up level, we watch the first half. I mean, we have a huge compilation put together by our buddy Mitch of Stairway to Stardom segments, and we just watch like the first half of those.
Yeah. Yeah. I think we should. I think there's like three DVDs. They're all about an hour long. And maybe we do one, we see if it's any fun, and then maybe we can do the other two. If it's too tedious, then, but it's not, it's so good. The show's so good.
It's like it's like the amateur talent show I think you showed last week. But it's that for like hours and hours. So
yeah. And the way that our buddy Mitch edited it all together is it's pretty quick. You know, he lets things breathe, but it's not too much. So
yeah. And it's culled from, I think the show aired from 1978 to 1992. So it's culled from decades of different episodes from the show. And the rumor was that Alec Baldwin watched the show growing up and really loved it. So it's got some celebrity fans. I think it's time we do an EP where people could see more of the.
Definitely. I want to do a Stairway to Stardom t-shirt. Wouldn't that be like a cool, like a 1970s font, Stairway to Stardom? You have all the guests around it. And
oh, yeah.
That could be
yeah.
a cool t-shirt.
You could even use their logo. Okay, we'll work on that. Okay, well, that wraps up That It'd Done, right, for this week?
Yep.
Okay.
That It'd Done. Oh, by the way, Andrew, That It'd Done.
Okay, good. Now it's official.
That's it. That It'd Done. Right there.
Next up, we've got a segment we do every week where we show off. We used to formerly called Show and Tell. Now it's called Show Us Your Raviolis.
Yeah, and this week we have we did this in chunks with the guy from Lunch Meat who does the Lunch Meat zine. We sat down with him and he showed us some videos from his collection. This particular one, I think it's called The Natural Way to Meet the Right Person or something like that. It's a dating video. It's for both men and women. And we spent a lot of time on this one. We took a deep dive on this one. And here again is the final installment of our meeting with Josh from Lunch Meat.
Come on, let's see your raviolis. Show us 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 your raviolis.
All right. Let's do Natural Way to Meet the Right Person.
Oh yeah, this dating video. God, yeah. I love the dating videos.
This is a weird one. We don't have this one.
No.
This is brand new. And it's for both sexes, and we have like the guide to meeting girls, and we have girls meeting guys. But this is like for both sexes can sit down and see what
ahead of its time.
Yeah.
1987, I believe.
Yeah.
Same year as Kideo.
Wow. I mean, yeah.
All right, so here it starts off with a great song, and I actually love the FBI warning. Like, look, I've never seen that FBI warning before.
Yeah, super strong.
Yeah. All right, so we'll kick off with a song, and then we'll – they have lots of reenactments, which I think is pretty cool.
Mm-hmm.
Love a video that has lots of reenactments. Kind of a 50 boogie-woogie. That's a toe tapper. She could be the one. Wait, what was that one?
Love's Silent Vows.
And also taking the... Oh, I thought it said snuggle. I like snuggle better.
Taking the snuggle out of dating?
That's what I was hoping for. Okay. She could be the one that makes it all worthwhile. Why men are the assholes that they are. The one that makes it
all worthwhile. That's always the stuff.
That's the problem. That's really the problem. Thing about these videos from back then is that they actually hired somebody to write these songs.
I know,
like an original song for
like I was thinking about that too, because it's like I these two vocalists that came in and were probably just doing this song, like they answered an ad or something, and they went in there and just like, you know, gave it their all one day, you know, like, where are these people?
The author of Single Straight Man, she finally unlocked the secrets behind those enigmas. She could be the one.
Well, I had hoped by this time of the night to be with someone besides you.
Well, you're not exactly my dream date either.
What is our problem? I mean, our mothers think we're cute. I'm serious. Have you ever...
I mean, what's that, 15 seconds in?
Yeah. Our mothers think we're cute. But the dialogue of these are Pert Plus commercials. Nick, do you remember Pert Plus? Josh, you remember Pert Plus commercials? I feel like we're way older than you, so I didn't... Yeah.
No, or yeah, yeah. I mean, absolutely.
Head and Shoulders. 'Tis the season for the flakes that don't melt.
Oh, was it Head and Shoulders?
That was Head and Shoulders.
Oh, okay, yeah.
But all shampoo commercials were about the same, I think.
Yeah, that's the one.
It's very that vibe.
It looks like these men are photo negatives of each other. He's got a tan coat and brown pants. He's got a brown coat and tan.
They're trying to compliment each other,
you know? And right.
Yeah. But you are absolutely right. It's a very good observation.
I think, yeah, it's yin yang.
I don't like how he touched the other guy. So overstep his bounds a little bit.
Oh, right there? Oh, yeah. Oh. The face, too. It's a weird face touch.
It's a little aggressive.
Someone besides you.
Well, you're not exactly my...
Oh, can you imagine, like, if we were talking, like, I touched your face? Would you not... You wouldn't like that.
Especially not now.
Yeah, I mean, if somebody's looking at that from across the room, you know, they might... But maybe you were going to get approached, and maybe now the woman doesn't know to approach you, you know?
Yeah. All right, so I'll just skip ahead. So then what they do, then they pan over to the women having a conversation.
Okay, let's see what they're doing.
You know, that one guy over there, he came over and we talked, and he left and never came back.
Yeah. I gave a guy my phone number, but I'm not going to hold my breath till he calls. I am so sick of guys asking you out, and then you never hear from them again. Why do they do that?
Is it us or is it them?
I don't know.
I mean... Why is it that we always seem to attract the guys that we're not interested in? There's one guy I wanted to meet, so I smiled at him, and he never came over. I wish I could project my thoughts to him and have some force bring him to me. There's only so much one can do.
Yeah, you don't want to seem too easy or too desperate.
But you don't want to seem too standoffish either.
No, did you see that cute couple that left together? I know they just met tonight.
Sound familiar? Well, we've all gone through that. But do you know that there are ways that each of us, male and female...
She's like a ghost that they can't see or hear? Is that the premise here?
Exactly.
Yeah, it's Spirit of Dating Future.
All right.
Yeah, it's very supernatural video. Yeah. All right, let's skip ahead to some of these reenact... Oh, so this part's really weird.
Yeah.
Josh, you'd put this time code in here for me to include.
This? Yeah, so, yeah.
Yeah, this is such a weird scene.
Oh, Don, I'm your biggest fan. I watch you every week. You know, my ex-husband never did like you. Did I mention I'm divorced now?
Judy, you're talking to cardboard.
Yeah, she's getting more response than I did on my last date.
Oh, yeah? You didn't tell me. Another candidate for a personality transplant?
Yeah, I'm afraid so.
Well, at least you had a date.
Well, you refused to go out.
Look, I'm just tired of the whole scene.
Linda, I think it's time you made an appointment to have your attitude realigned.
Listen, you guys wanted your pictures taken or what?
No, but can I take him home?
I don't think so.
Oh, you must be shattered.
Maybe even devastated.
It's so weird.
And then
she
touches her inappropriately, too.
And on her head.
Yeah.
Yeah. So they're out in this whatever parking lot with cardboard cutouts of Ronald Reagan and Don Johnson talking to them, and then the guy says, do you want me to take your picture with them? And then they'd say no.
It's like one of those photo ops, dude, where you're like, you could say you met Don Johnson, but you try to fool people.
Yeah, if you're in front of a gift shop on Hollywood Boulevard, yeah, but a desolate parking lot in a residential neighborhood, I mean,
this is a video about dating. It's just like, it's such a long walk and such a stretch to, all right.
They didn't want to have to cast any guys. So.
Yeah. So, all right, we'll skip ahead. Oh, yeah. So, this is the blind date scene, I think.
Oh, man. Yeah, this one's... Yeah.
Okay, so this is the guy on the blind date, and he meets... Mm-hmm.
You must be Les... Lee.
Hi. You must be Mark.
The truth is...
All right, so he had some success with that one.
Yeah, so the thing about that was he's standing there at the door right there before she opens the door, and she's like, she's probably going to be a dog.
Yeah, yeah.
Says that. And then he's open up, and she's a blind person with a dog.
She's blind?
Yeah, dude, I think that's her seeing eye dog, dude. I'm pretty sure. So I think that she's actually on a blind date. That's my impression. If you want
to
watch it again.
If they're trying to be funny, or...
Yeah, I think it's like, oh, she's going to be a dog. And then
Here it is.
She's gonna be a dog. I just know it. I don't want to do this. Oh, come on. Ring the bell. You're about to meet someone new, and at worst, it'll take an hour of your time.
You must be Les. Lee.
Hi, you must be Mark.
The truth is,
I don't think it was seeing iDog though. I think they were.
I don't know. Maybe I'm there. Just. I don't know. That's the impression I got.
See, that's why we do the show, so that we can all watch it together.
Yeah.
I think
the video is not subtle. I think she would have been wearing dark glasses, and it would have been one of those bar leashes on the German
Fair
Shepherd.
Enough. But, I think
what they did. I see what you're thinking because it's blind date and they're being blind. But I think that he's thinking she's a dog. They cut to the dog, and then she's holding the dog. So I don't know. I think that's it.
Jury's out, but yeah, or it could have been a failed attempt to make a joke there.
Yeah. All right. So here's the woman on the blind date.
It's ridiculous. I can't do this. I wonder if he noticed if I wasn't here. Come on now. You
hey, lady, can you quick think and chill out?
How bad can he be?
I'm trying to clean off this glass.
Good show. Get out of my way. Now come here.
I wish Curtis Arms found that.
Hey, yo. Let's see what we got here. Black jacket, blonde hair follicles. It must be London. You got to be London.
He's
guessing right. Decided to go with the name tag. Say, what you say we down 10, 12 beers, and then maybe we could get something to eat? I might like you better we slept together. I might like you better we slept together. Come on.
What happens?
All right. So that's the woman's.
So he looks like Johnny Rotten, but he talks like Tom Waits. That was the decision that he made.
Oh,
yeah.
Here's a good scene. This is the auction scene. Like they're saying, like if you should think outside of the box. Don't go to bars. I think that's what they're trying to tell you with that. Don't go to bars. Go to weird things like auctions or I think they have another one
that's
like
a
poetry reading. Yeah. So this one's at an auction.
Is this priceless authentic replica of an ancient African fertility god? Let's start the bidding at $150, please. I have 150. Can I get 175? I see we have two people bidding for the same object. Can I have 185, please? The same two bidders. 195. 195, going once, twice, sold!
We got it.
But it's a weird scene where they put the music on and it's just like on top of it.
About the African fertility.
Well, you'll see.
I think it's time we bid this place goodbye. What do you think?
Let's go.
People who don't meet the right person are dating the wrong kind of.
Yeah,
I mean, he's definitely going to get her pregnant. He's got the fertility thing.
Yeah. Right.
It's a replica too, so it might not even work.
Oh yeah,
they're taking a chance, you know.
Plus, also those people are probably like 23 years old too, aren't they?
Or younger.
Yeah, I just feel like,
I don't know.
Well, just people back then were way younger than you thought they were. They all looked old, but maybe that's like our, whatever.
The hair, the shoulder pads.
Yeah. Josh, are there any other moments in this that you want to,
There's those pickup lines that you just passed. If you go back a little bit, it's like they're sitting at a bar. Keep going.
There's the poetry.
There's the poetry.
Wait.
I think
the
next one is.
There's a line of dialogue that I like here, of the guys when they first come to the poetry reading.
Please, places,
you know,
can be a meeting.
Yeah.
Ground.
Hey guys, let me ask this one more time. Why in the name of Carl Sandburg are we at a poetry reading?
Since I promised the Binker we'd be here.
Yeah, and where do you know this guy from?
From college.
Yeah, and how long has he been a poet?
Since IBM broomed him last week.
Listen.
'Tis the season for the flakes that don't melt.
Since IBM broomed him, meaning they fired him. Cool lingo.
There's the poet. It's just
the
so
poetry is horrible. Yeah, it's
so much. Yeah, is this the one?
No, there's more. If you go further,
I didn't
up.
Get this far into it.
This could be a good EP mode. There's a lot of good stuff in here.
There is. There's a lot of reenactments.
Oh, there's so much good stuff in here.
Is it this one?
No.
Okay. Well, I don't know. Let's
There it was.
Oh, it was? After that?
A little before this.
Before the karate.
Oh, before the karate?
Yeah, before the karate. Yeah, here.
Oh, right here. Okay.
Mem said hello. This is my name. I think I'd like that more than haven't I met you before?
Haven't I seen you somewhere before?
You know? You look just like my ex-wife.
Hey, can I have a picture of you, or would you like to come over and live on my dresser?
Hey, babe. Nice looking growth.
Oh, they couldn't even help laughing.
I guess that's a no, too.
What did he say?
I guess that's a no, too.
What? They're all laughing.
Yeah, they're all like losing it there.
Yeah, so they're having some fun.
She should have just gone for it. She just kind of like sprinkled a little bit on his forehead. Like she should have just like splashed in his face. I mean, that's what Diddy is about, right?
Well, you gotta go that's for Monday it. Morning quarterbacking, you know.
Nice looking growth. I guess that's a note.
And also, they're dressed very similarly.
They are.
They are. Yeah. He needs a necklace, and they're practically twins. So,
Josh, is there any more from this one, or should we? I mean, I'm going to keep this in my personal collection. I'm going to watch the whole thing. It's so good.
Yeah. There's a lot in it. So, I mean, if you can find a copy of it, and it is, you know.
Yeah.
I put it on my channel, so it's all there.
The whole thing is on there.
Yeah.
Okay. Now would be a good time to promote your channel.
Oh yeah. So I just started uploading stuff to the Lunch Meet YouTube recently because I was just never really did it. I was just focused on writing and you know projects and everything like that. But you know since we've been quarantined, I'm like, well, I might as well start loading some stuff up. So putting some stuff up there. Yeah.
Nice. So what is it? Is it Lunch Meet? It's just.
It's not Lunch Meet VHS on YouTube. Yeah.
Okay. Lunch Meet VHS on YouTube.
Oh, so if you want to watch the whole thing and learn how to meet the right person.
Okay. The natural way.
Come on, let's see your raviolis. Show us your raviolis.
Thanks again to Josh Schaefer, and it's Lunch Meet VHS on YouTube. He just started a YouTube channel, and he's doing some good work. So
good dude. Just
yeah.
Solid dude.
Good egg, and I'm envious of his I don't know, library, VHS library, whatever he's got behind him in that shot. So,
yeah, it looked like a good one. I think ours might be a little better.
Yeah, I think it's a little bigger. But
I think you're being nice there. But
it was cute. I'll just say it was cute. Yeah. Thanks again. We'll have Josh back. Shall we get into nice things?
Let's get into nice things.
Yeah. Well, I'm excited because I'm told George has a nice thing. Let's save his for the end. Joe, do you want to start off? These are just things that we find nice.
Sure. Well, first of all, I'm going to show this nice thing. This is it's my 5-year wedding anniversary to my wife, Albertina, who's been on the show. And here's a mug that some friends made. We were at the Vatican, and we did the jump. This is where I didn't propose to her at the Vatican, but in Italy I proposed to her. And we went to the Vatican. We're like, oh, let's do the jump. Or we're like jumping for joy. We're here.
Was this before or after the proposal?
It was after the proposal. Well, no, it was before. I hadn't proposed.
This is the same wife that you humiliated on Quarantine Classics last week?
Yeah, we don't talk about that anymore.
Okay, got it. Just wanted to make sure. But that's a sweet mug. No, it's sweet.
All right, so here's some of the nice things. Most of these nice things were sent in from Melinda's. But they're very nice things that deserve to be in the segment nice things. This first one is from Ross. Do you see that?
Absolutely. He did our VCR party trading cards.
Yeah.
Wow.
Ross, yeah, he did our VCR party trading cards, and he also did this one of the Price Master. He took, I think that's an 89 Donruss, and he turned it into the Price Master. And look what the price of the Price Master card is at the bottom. $400 million.
Everything's for sale.
Next up. So we showed that Rubik's Cube video last week, and while I was putting together the end credits, and I came across this name. You know, we're putting together like a name montage, written by Dick Snoke.
Yeah, I mean,
and that's a nice thing. That's a nice name, which equals a nice thing.
And by the way, we're going to play in a minute our interview with Scotty, the kid from this video, who called us back right after last week's episode when we left him a voicemail, and we asked her about Dick Snoke, so we'll get to the bottom of that.
Yep. All right, next up, Scott. So Scott Rail, longtime Melinda, he was on a big company Zoom, and he took this screenshot, and look at, so there's Scott up in the top, and there, look at that.
That's wow, nice he did thing. It.
He put a Joe's Tedium corner.
Well, so
I didn't ask him if anybody made a comment about it. It doesn't look like, it looks like some people have like flower
yeah,
backgrounds.
Yeah, they did funny backgrounds too.
He has a Joe's Tedium corner. And look, he kind of has a tedious expression on
him. I mean, like most people on Zoom meetings, he looks miserable. But yeah, so I mentioned this last week, but George put together a batch of, for anybody who's a patron, even at the $5 level and above, you get a package of Zoom backgrounds. And I would love if more people sent photos like this with those incorporated.
Yeah. All right. So everybody remembers this guy, Dark Lord Blood, correct? You guys all remember him.
From of course, who could forget?
It was from a daytime talk show. He was the Satanist. And then everybody, of course, remembers this guy, John Anderson, from New Age Miracles. He's the host. He's trying to debunk New Age theories or New Age shit. Who was it who sent it in? Jeff Morin. He's illustrated some cool stuff before. He put together this comic book that's so awesome. Dark Lord Blood comic book. Look perfect. How goddamn cool that is.
Ambushed by John Anderson, master of New Age Miracles.
I want to read this comic. We should write up like the first story. And I don't know. How do you make comic books? Let's make a comic book.
Yeah, you write it up and describe what should be drawn in the panels and then let Jeff go nuts on it. I don't know if he'd have the bandwidth to make something like that, but I'd read it.
Well, there are many comic book creators in the Melindaverse, and one of them, writer Will Pfeiffer, comic book writer of, I think he did Catwoman and stuff. Maybe he'd be interested in taking a crack at writing it. We get
absolutely.
The Melindas. We outsource the whole thing.
Yeah.
That way we just get to read it.
Yeah. Yeah, we could do that. We could just have all the comic book people make a Dark Lord Blood comic.
I did send this to Dark Lord Blood, and he was like, holy shit. Like, I think he's just amazed that this thing still has a life. That whole Dark Lord Blood.
And I like that Dark Lord Blood's the hero of the, you know what I mean? It's his.
Oh, he's the hero of this comic.
Yeah, right. I mean, it's named after him. Yeah.
He's being ambushed by John Anderson.
He's an anti-hero, like Ghost Rider.
Well, I think he's a complicated hero. I think his heart is in the right place, but maybe he does do some bad things along the way.
His heart's in the right place, but his mustache is in the wrong place.
That's the tagline. last thing I want to show you. So maybe about a month ago, Dave Hawkins, he sent me some spam because I think we had just played Urine Good Health, the documentary about urine, like drinking your own urine for health purposes. And I think we just played that. And he sent me a spam that he got with a great subject line. Check your urine smell for this. Could be linked to disease. And then it was sent by pee smell.
It's sent by HF, but... locally known as peace
at helpfamily.net. And you know, spam, of course, spam's always going to be goofy and weird, but this is particularly good stuff. He sent me another one yesterday. He said, hey, I got another pee related spam that you might enjoy. So here's the subject line: stretch this muscle to stop embarrassing pee leaks, women only. And this one, I also like the start of the email too. Today we have something a bit more sensitive, and then it cuts off. Here's who it's from. Pee your pants.
By employ, otherwise known as pee your pants.
employ@gotanyjobs.com.
I don't know why this is ending up in a spam filter. I mean, doesn't he have any friends named pee your pants or pee smell? You'd think this would just come to the top of your inbox.
It's also all lowercase. It's a lowercase name. So
well, please
those are my nice things.
Keep them coming, Dave. Thank you for that. I have a few other things that were sent in or shared on Twitter for my nice things. First of all, Marshall Banana on Twitter sent me this. This is nice. Her dog with one of our Frisbee fuckers, Frisbee, celebrating the German porno by the same name. Cute dog. Marty is not a Frisbee kind of dog, so he hasn't... He just kind
of
looks at it.
A relaxing kind of dog.
Yeah, he's
right?
More of a relaxing kind of dog.
Just kind of sitting around kind of a dog.
Yep.
Okay.
This is sent, this was by somebody on Twitter who goes by the name Salad Bar Ham Cubes, which is also a great Twitter name, posted this, and it's "Learn about beef with the beef kids" by the New Mexico Beef Council.
That's for real, isn't it?
That's for real, yeah. It's a real pamphlet that I wish I had found, but God bless you, Salad Bar Ham Cubes. Now, this is a video. This is the video that I was talking about before. This is they've been on eBay. You can buy tapes that are sold as blank, but they have stuff on them. So those are like, we have a whole section of sold as blank tapes that we find at Goodwills that you know, it's somebody's Golden Girls reruns that they tape, but who knows what's on it. So this one. You can see what caught my eye about it was it says ALF on the cover, and then it says done, and then it says audio trouble here. But certain things were crossed out, and on the face label, here's what was crossed out. I don't know if you can read it. It says Mama's Family. So this tape has a lot of history to it. Somebody was taping Mama's Family. They decided to make room for ALF, so I had to respect that. And
wow.
Speaking of ALF, I have an alert. That's a transition I use a lot on this show. But I have an alert set for on like, you know how at Google Alerts you can set it to alert you when a string comes up that you're looking for. Like I have one set for Found Footage Festival to see if any press comes out about the show. I also have one set for ALF costume vintage. To see if any vintage ALF costumes come up. Well, in this case, this photo came up recently, and after a long drought of nothing coming up, and it was worth the wait. It's a small person, maybe a kid playing, wearing an ALF costume and playing Outrun in an arcade. And this is just,
That's about ALF's height, too.
Yeah, I think it is, yeah. So if anybody's looking for like a tattoo idea, this is a perfect photo, and you know, it's just got everything you want. So
that's not actual ALF, is it? Is that actual ALF?
I don't know, let me zoom in. I don't know, that looks TV quality.
I think that is actual ALF,
probably.
Yeah.
Well, weigh in the comments. Those are my nice things. Now on to George's nice thing.
I just have one quick nice thing that I guess in a sponsor aggregator has been checking what I've been Googling. And so this came up. This is a Wilford Brimley diabetes guitar pedal.
Whoa!
And each eye lights up depending on, it's a tremolo, which is the sound at the beginning of Crimson and Clover, and a fuzz, which is like a satisfaction. So if you can do both, or you can do each of those individually, and one eye lights up for each of those effects. So that's pretty
so
great.
Cool. Diabetes.
Yeah.
If you got diabetes, you got to do something about it, you son of a bitch.
algorithm works.
Yeah. If he ever appears at any of those celebrity conventions ever again, I'll come back to him with that guitar pedal, get his reaction to it.
Get his autograph on it.
I'm sure I'll be thrilled. And anything else for nice things?
That's it. Close it up.
Okay, we mentioned this before, but Joe, you called up George in real time, found the kid from the Rubik's Cube video, and just to give you a reminder of why we were so enchanted by him, here's from the video called Rubik's Cube Solved.
Come on in, Scotty.
Whoops, man.
Another person who's interested in solving puzzles is my helper here today, Scotty Beasley. Hi, Scotty.
Hi.
How old are you, Scotty?
9.
9 years old. Where do you live?
Boulder, Colorado.
I guess you go to school.
Uh-huh.
Oh, I've been asking you a lot of questions. Is there anything you'd like to know about me?
Well, can you solve this?
Well, that's a fair enough question. Let's see what I can do.
Let me just zoom it ahead to the outro, because Scotty appears again.
You have to make right away. Now turn the top face and the bottom face. Well, I didn't have to tell you what the last move was. Your cube is solved. And your cube will be solved too once you get to the end of stage 6. This fellow's becoming a real cubic.
All right. So, I mean, captivating character. George found him. You called him. He called us back immediately, right? Like, as soon as we got done taping?
He called me back right away, and he was so excited about it, and he's just like, wow, you guys found me. And he had completely forgotten about it. He said that he didn't even think he had seen the video before. Like, he never even saw the finished product. So, yeah. So then we called him last night. And he's a great dude.
Oh, so good sense of humor about it. And, well, here's our interview with Scotty Beasley, the kid from Rubik's Cube Solved from 1981.
Scott, thank you.
Hello.
For starting our phone call. Yes.
My pleasure. Thanks for calling.
It was a terrible voicemail message, too. It wasn't very good. It was kind of rambling. And I think that I took a long time to get to the point. And but you returned the call.
You're being too hard on yourself. It was very charming. It's like, this is an ordinary, cool guy. I got to call him back and say, hey.
You're damn right I am. awesome.
Well, the reason we were so excited to meet you is because found this video, Rubik's Cube Solved, and sure enough, the kid in the video was named Scott Beasley, and our VHS detective found a guy matching this description, and
there it is.
and
can I stare awkwardly into the middle distance?
Perfect.
Yeah.
That was me a long time ago, fellas.
How did this come about? This was 1981, right?
Yeah, yeah. And it was an awkward time in life when I insisted everyone call me Scotty. I now can't stand that because it's maybe for a 9-year-old boy it's becoming, but when you're past a certain age, it's either too effeminate or douchey. I can't decide which.
Well, you know, I went by Joey up until sixth grade. At sixth grade, I was like, nope, I'm Joe.
I'm a man now.
Yes, exactly. I'm a man.
I did the same thing, Joe. Exactly.
Yes.
Totally. So the backstory with that, you want me to jump in and tell you where that came from?
Exactly. We're curious.
So mom, I grew up in like Southwest Boulder, kind of in the foothills of Boulder in the Table Mesa area. In the 70s and 80s, that city really had a sense of humor about itself. It was mostly hippies and college professors and students. It was kind of before it was discovered and everyone moved there and it got really expensive. Yeah. And so my mom was a working mom, a single mom, and I went to a daycare, in-home daycare in Louise's house. And Louise is the producer.
Oh, it's coming
together. So Louise's husband, I think I remember this correctly. It's been a while, so forgive me if I'm totally off, if anyone's fact-checking this, but Louise's husband, I think, was a CU professor.
Okay.
And that professor's buddy was the guy that came up with the Rubik's solution, and they needed some little cohort to act as a foil for his teaching of the Rubik's Cube solution. And I was kind of a ham, and I loved puzzles. I had like a collection of puzzles. And so here's this, you know, one of the kids that goes to their daycare. Let's throw him in there. He's nice enough. And
perfect.
And there it goes.
I noticed, though, in the end credits, though, I think the art director's last name was Beasley, which is your last name.
Good call, Joe. That's my mom.
So your mom was the art director on this, too.
They're being kind of generous there. I mean, if you look at the if you look at the art, and mom, if you're seeing this someday down the road, I don't mean to take anything away from your mastery of color, but you'll notice the background is just like black.
Yes.
I'm pretty sure she painted the cube, and I'm pretty sure she painted those square frames that were back there.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, the giant cube hanging up. And so this comes out on VHS, I guess, right? It wasn't ever on TV, right? It was a video-only release. Was there a reaction from, like, friends at school? Did it ever get back to you that they saw you in this?
I think it was a total commercial failure, as far as I know. Nobody ever saw it. I mean, in fact, I think you were the first two to see it since 1981.
I was just going to say, are we the first people to ever ask you about this?
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Yes.
I wanted it so bad to be cool when I was in fourth grade. I was like, hey, guys, with my big coconut head haircut, guess what I did? I could do this. And nobody cared. And it went away. Because remember, it was kind of a fad. And by the time the post-production was done, the fad had kind of passed.
Right. I actually was so impressed with the video that I went out and got a Rubik's Cube, and I've been trying to
go through the doctor's lessons and learn how to solve it. It's tough, but you seem to get it in the video.
I've tried since, and it's not, I can't do it now. I think I could if I sat down, because I kind of remember the general strategy from what he says. It's like, find the middle part and then the stringers on the sides and then wind up with the corners, and it's this shapes that you think, I don't know. I've taken them apart.
Oh, yeah?
Well, I took the stickers off. Yeah, I did that, yeah.
It just never looks the same.
No.
I have a question for you. I was looking in the credits, and I noticed this guy, Dick Snoke.
Oh wait, Snoke. We're having a cat cameo, a gray cat.
Sorry,
oh,
cat attack.
We got a cat.
All right.
That is Ted.
Oh, hi, Ted.
So I'm wondering, did you ever meet Dick Snoke? And the only reason I ask is because I like his name, Dick Snoke. he's the writer.
He might have been Louise's husband.
Oh, really?
God, I don't remember, guys. My mom would know that because that name is still familiar. It kind of sticks out. I think that was Louise's husband. I think he was like... him and the doctor guy with the bad collar and Louise. Yeah, I think that was pretty much it for behind the camera.
Yeah. It was mostly an excuse just to say the name Dick Snow.
It was a weird trope of the time that like there was like, you know, older men with like young proteges. You know, there's like Mr. Wizard always had like two young boys around him experimenting, and it doesn't quite read the same now, but it was all very innocent at the time. Yeah,
different time. Yeah.
Such an innocent age.
Yes.
So somebody on our Facebook page had a question about something that you were doing in the video. Let me just bring it up here so you can see it. Aaron, one of our Melindas asked, middle finger or just doing a weird thing with his hand? Exhibit A. You see that? That is totally something a kid would do to sneak in a middle finger. Did you?
All right.
Can you tell us?
I don't want to talk about this, but that is a very secretive Illuminati symbol.
Aha! Aha! It's been told.
You've worked it out of me. You broke me down.
Yes, you heard it here first.
Secrets revealed.
In fact, the Rubik's Cube is an Illuminati symbol and passageway.
Oh, no. Oh, no. I'm getting brainwashed right now.
Yes, careful.
Okay.
All right. You mentioned
she's on to me.
You, when we were setting up here, you mentioned you had a daughter who is, did you show her the footage at all? Has she seen any of this? What does she think about it?
I think I showed her the GIF that you bounced back to me on text.
Oh, yeah.
I haven't shared it around enough, and I'd like to, and I plan to.
Are you proud of it? You're proud of it, right?
Sure. Yeah. Own it, right?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Lead into the awkwardness.
What are you doing now? Is puzzle solving in enter into your modern life at all?
There's a high degree of that in my job that pays me a wage, the real estate side of my life. I think it's what keeps me doing that job.
You're solving puzzles in a way, right? Finding.
And no kidding. There's something to that. You're putting things together and you're helping and you get the details right. And there you go to the closing and everybody's happy.
Right. Well, I would love to see if you're ever bored in quarantine, if you could pick it, if it's like riding a bike, if you could pick it back up, I would love to see it in action.
I appreciate that, Nick. I'll look around. I think I might have a cube in storage somewhere. I had a bunch of them after that video. Like I started collecting them and I had one that was the different die faces of a six-sided dice, like the single dot.
I've seen that one. Yes.
Yeah. Oh, there's got to be some collector's items in there somewhere.
Yes.
Yeah. Well, we were fascinated by the video, and you stole the show, and the soundtrack was great, too. I mean, it was a perfect storm. I mean, I'm sorry it was a commercial flop, because it's been an indelible video for us.
Maybe we can resurrect that. Maybe we can, maybe it's ready for the mainstream now. Because I think Rubik's Cube is getting bigger now, right now. They have those competitions, and people finish them in, like, 8 seconds now, and Yeah, it's insane. Yeah. But
isn't there a guy that juggles and solves it while he's juggling a bunch of them or something crazy?
That sounds about right.
I saw footage of that. Yeah.
Superhuman.
Well, if real estate somehow doesn't work out for you, I mean, it is working out. What am I saying? But if you need a fallback, I mean, you clearly have the skills. So.
You can always just call up Dick Snoke and just say, hey, look.
Doesn't he sound like the accountant for Darth Maul or something? He's like a Sith Lord accountant.
Exactly who he is. A Sith accountant.
Perfect.
Yes.
Perfect. Dick Snoke.
Richard Snoke, CPA.
Awesome.
He's a low-level Death Star guy. Thank you so much for chatting. Appreciate it. I've got my room right here. I'm doing my Illuminati gesture here. And
look at you.
Huh.
Thank you, guys. Scott. Thank you both very much. It's been a blast, and thanks for involving me. And thanks for bringing the video back out to the world consciousness.
Yes, thanks for doing it. Good night.
All right, have a good one.
We got to send him something. I don't know what you send him. He probably has every Rubik's Cube, but...
Yeah,
I don't know.
He's got to be something.
Yeah, but he's in real estate now. I don't know. Maybe we buy a house from him or.
Yeah, let's do that.
Some way to repay him. Yeah. So thanks again to Scotty Beasley in Colorado. What a guy. Yeah. Cyber videos? Should we do
let's
it?
Let's watch some cyber videos on the internet.
I got a quick one to start us off here. And this one is actually, Bob Hedges sent this in. And it's got a slow build up, but the payoff's worth it. So if we could just observe silence during this one, I think it'll pay off. That's it. It's a dying sound of I think it's called the world's worst elevator ringtone. So here it is again.
One more time. It's just wheezing. It's more of a wheeze.
Like put it out of its misery.
Yeah.
If anybody knows how to do flash animation or anything, if somebody could make like a dying pterodactyl and set it to that, or whatever you think that sounds like, I would like to see that.
Yeah. Oh yeah. That's a great sound effect. Yes. That people can put under dying things.
Yeah. Or maybe it could be like the next Wilhelm scream. Well, you know, sound editors can use that in movies when somebody's going off a cliff or whatever.
Yes.
So, it's balls in your court, Melendez. Who's up next?
George, what do you got?
Let's see. So there was the commercial, You and Your Johnson. It was a motorboat commercial from, that you showed a few months back that had a great jingle, had a great double entendre. I wasn't sure if it was real. It was real. And I found some other video, I found two quick commercials that are in that vein. These are real, by the way.
The name of the game is Ball Buster.
I need this game.
It's a family game, fun for children. And for adults, it's exciting. You make strategic offensive and defensive moves. Then try to bust your opponent's balls. It's as easy as checkers. But exacting like pool. You're a ball buster.
That was
real. Ball buster. A great new game from Mego.
And then in the 90s, you have a very similar...
Turn up the fun with ball sack.
Turn it up!
Ball sack, balloon in a sack, blow it up now, give it a whack. Turn up the fun with ball sack. Hit it, boy, some water too. I fly real quick, now ain't that cool? Turn up the fun with ball sack.
Check it out.
And here's my little buddy, the ball sack brat.
Us two ball jacks are where it's at.
This is Brett. Turn up the fun with ball sack. Turn up the fun with ball sack.
And it's a great, reference? Great tribute
Is that Jeremiah Balzac?
That's Honoré de Balzac, the writer of the human comedy from the early 19th century. Great French novelist.
And that's and what that water
that's his legacy.
Was referencing. Yeah. Yes, that's okay. That's what I thought. Gotcha. Oh, that was a great Dana Carvey show sketch.
Yeah, I feel like it was being pranked.
But those are both real, yeah.
Steve, what do you got?
I'm going to go back to anyone who's watched Frenchie the Creek knows that I absolutely love when you guys, either of you guys, do a sketch. This one has never been featured on Found Footage. Doesn't have a lot of views. Our friend Justin Wilson, I believe, wrote it. You have to remind me, 'cause it's been a while. But it features our one and only Nick Prewer.
Well, I think it was, he wanted to do a spec thing. I think that he was like doing an advertising thing, or he's trying to get in with an advertising company. So he did something on spec for Sparkle paper towels. And I think the three of us, me, Nick, and Steve, and Justin, we all worked on it. And Nick was the talent behind this.
I haven't seen it since. So
This is going to be fun.
All right.
Gosh dang it. I'm a guy who knows what he likes. My morning paper, a steaming hot cup of coffee, paintings by Thomas Kincaid. But when it comes to shopping for the right paper towel, your guess is as good as mine. Randomly, I grabbed two brands off the shelf, Sparkle and The Leading Brand. I went home and devised a series of elaborate, time-consuming experiments to determine which brand was good enough to get the job done. First, I will drop a meatball on a square of The Leading Brand. Now for Sparkle. Now, for some reason, I'll pour a pitcher of blue liquid on a square of The Leading Brand. And now on a sheet of Sparkle. The proof is in the pudding. Let's see how strong these cocksuckers are. That settles it. I recently lost a loved one, and it made me realize just how precious time is. So why waste it in the supermarket? Sparkle. It's good enough.
Wow, I hadn't
seen that. That was funny. I forgot how funny that was. Yeah.
I still don't know why we did it, but it was really funny.
Yeah, I don't remember the why, but, George was talking earlier, there are, comic book writers out in the Melindaverse. Maybe there's some ad execs. I'm just pitching. Nick should be your next pitch man, you know?
Absolutely, yeah. Joe, we've got IMG mining. We mentioned this up top, right? These are where people are saying, and we've been getting like dozens of emails a day from people
more
who
than
put
that.
In
we,
IMG.
We, okay, so Nick explained it before. You type in IMG and then any four numbers into YouTube, and you're going to get 15, like IMG 1500. Well, you'll get 15 things, and most of them will be really boring and accidental, but there will be at least one or two gems on each number. Now, I also found out if you do an IMG underscore four numbers, you get a completely different list. If
right.
you do IMG no space, you get a completely different list. So there's so much shit out there that nobody's ever seen before. And so I put it out last week for IMG miners to come on to email me, and I'll give you an assignment. I gave everybody 20 IMG numbers. And we got over 50 responses. We have over 50 miners right now working in the caves of YouTube to mine gold. And it's a little bit daunting, actually. There's so much stuff that's coming back that's so good because it doesn't take much. Like Steve's 235 weight, that was the first thing that popped up, jumping over toilet paper. I mean, that's just the tip of the iceberg. So I want to share just a couple things that came back. Robo Ito sent me this one. I think this is for his birthday, which is 0707. It's a scary one. So you're going to see scary ones occasionally. That's the thing. It's, what was it? 0707. Let me look. It's, here we go. Robo Ito's birthday.
There's one crazy motherfucker out there, man. Why a motherfucker crazy? That motherfucker real crazy. That motherfucker real crazy.
Okay.
So that's look at all the drums. All the drum heads and behind them. Yeah, that's good. And happy birthday, Robo Ito.
Let me just show one that Bob sent of 0804. And this is a woman describing her bacon recipe. And he said that his favorite part about it was you can hear in the background the smoke detector. It's running low on batteries, so you can hear a little chirp. All right? I'm just going to turn this one up so you can hear a little bit more.
Okay, here we are, 5 minutes, and we've made some beautiful crispy bacon, and I haven't made a huge mess, and it's just absolutely perfect, just nice and crispy. So I love the Small Ridge Baker. You can also do meatloaves on it. You can do chicken on it.
I didn't hear it. Did you hear it?
I heard the first one. Yeah.
You heard the
only
chirp?
One? Yeah.
I heard okay, one yeah, chirp. There's only one chirp. I missed it. Yeah.
It's funny how many home movies we find where they have somebody doesn't have their battery is low on the smoke detector. The guy who's watching internet porn and taping it, and then the cat walks by, we've showed it on the show before, you can hear his battery chirping too occasionally on that one. So
let me just show one more. This is a 3 second one, and I'm starting to see how this, because I talked about this being like a feature length movie. And I'm trying to think how the story or the flow of the whole thing is, or how is it going to be presented? Is it going to be just a bunch of out of context videos that we're going to see? Or for example, with this next one, maybe we'll see, maybe one chapter will be called 3 second videos. This is a 3 second video, IMG 0522. And I think it had 11 views for some reason. 11 seems high for this one.
Rocks are done. Gotta sleep. Bye.
Rocks are done. Gotta sleep. Bye.
I mean, this needs to be added to the end of the show as a sign off. That's all. That's it. Rocks are done. Bye.
Gotta sleep. One more time.
Rocks are done. Gotta sleep. Bye.
So yeah, definitely. Let's definitely add that to the ending.
George may have a new sign off. We'll see.
Okay. So if you want to get in as an IMG miner, drop us a line, info@foundfootagefest.com. I'm a little backed up if I haven't responded to your emails just because I've gotten so many and I'm still pouring through all of them. So I'm going to get to them tomorrow. But yeah, reach out to me and thanks to everybody who have already mined things. Because Melinda's know the sensibility. They know the correct sensibility. They send the right stuff. So
yeah, I've been so impressed with the stuff people are sending in. Thank you. And that's a little bit of how to watch cyber videos on the internet.
Okay, so kind of a new thing have been the Melinda mixes, where we put out a sound and then a Melinda has recorded it and sampled it and made it into a whole new song. So we have three great Melinda mixes, actually four. We're going to close the show with a Melinda mix. But this first one was sent from Adam Kerr. And he, remember Basic Training for Boys that we watched with Craig Rowan for EP mode? He took the scene, the dishwasher scene, where Jamal and Napoleon does the dishes, Jamal does a dance and plays DJ. He changed the song and he calls it a basic, I can't remember what he called it. But here's what it, he calls it a game of the eyes have it before your mom sounds the alarm. I don't know. So.
How about you wash, I'll dry, and be the DJ? Cool.
The eyes have it. 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 The eyes have it.
And it makes no sense to anybody who hasn't seen and is intimately familiar with every aspect of this show. It's like two videos that we played once and they're mashed up. But you could add any song to Jamal doing the dishes. And all right, sorry, Napoleon doing the dishes. Look at Steve's got a little.
Yeah, poop. I'm dog sitting the next couple of days. This is Henry. He decided he wanted to be on camera. He's been roaming around in the back.
He's cute.
What a sweet boy.
Yeah, he's a good boy.
Okay, so Nick wrote some. Nick wrote's really good too. He sent a remix to Rubik's Cube with Dave's Lip Smacks. If you remember Dave Hawkins, who got the email from Pee Your Pants, Dave, his bottom lip got engorged from eating sushi one time. I think he must have had a shellfish allergy or something. And he made these lip smack sounds that I played last week so that somebody could sample it as a drum beat. Nick wrote, he went for it. He also mixed it with the Rubik's Cube music. So I just took a little section of that and I added some video to it. So here is Nick Groat's
Stage 6. Stage 6. Stage 6. This fellow's becoming a real cube expert.
This fellow.
Yeah, so that's a good one.
That's my favorite Nine Inch Nails song, easily.
So good.
Okay, and this is one of my favorites here. Joe Blevins, he has a Tumblr page called Both of Them Mary Worth, and you have to go visit this page because it's so good. I've honestly, let me first play the video. This comes from an IMG mine. Let me play the original IMG. This is IMG 1013 of a family doing freestyle rapping.
Jeep, give me no jive, don't give me no peep. Going for a walk with a loggy dog. Mess with me, will turn you into a hog. Ooba-ba-dooba, ooba-ba-dooba,
ooba-dooba-dooba, ooba-dooba-dooba.
Boom, boom, boom.
I'm here with my cousin I haven't seen for many years. I don't know how many years it's been, maybe 12 or more. But here I am today.
Waiting at the store.
Went to the park with the doggy doos, and guess what they did? Doody doo doo.
Daisy Duty, that's her name. Gone Duty is her claim to fame.
That reminds me, I gotta get.
Okay, so that's the original, and Joe Blevins, genius, took that and made it into an actual rap, like that it actually sounds like a rap. So here's his version of it.
I don't know how you can improve upon the original, but okay. Okay, Joe. Ooh-ba-ba-dooba, ooh-ba-ba-dooba,
ooh-ba-ba-dooba, ooh-ba-ba-dooba. Going for a walk with a loggy dog. Mess with me will turn you into a hog.
I'm here with my cousin I haven't seen for many years. I don't know how many years it's been, maybe 12 or more, but here I am.
Went to the park with the doggy doos, and guess what they did?
Daisy Duty, that's her name. Gone Duty is her claim to fame. Ooh-ba-ba-dooba, 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 ooh-ba-ba-dooba.
I've been singing that all week long.
It's very experimental. It's, yeah, I really like the beat that he put behind it.
My favorite part is, went to the park with the doggy-doo, and guess what he did? Doody-doo-doo.
Just keep those coming. Those are really good.
Well, oh, they're so good. Yeah. I love them so much.
And we got a good one to go out on. Just quickly before we end, I want to say that this week, EP Mode, we're going to be watching Stairway to Stardom. Excited for that. So if you are at the $10 and above level, it's our bonus show. A lot of Stairway to Stardom dropping Thursday. Frenchie and the Creep, that's the Found Footage Festival review show coming out tomorrow. What's on tap, guys?
Episode 0 of VCR Party Live.
Wow. We're switching it up. Yeah, a little curveball.
From what, a year and a half ago? Or
more than two.
Yeah, 2 years.
2 years ago. Okay. Interesting. I have not, nor do I want to revisit that. So
it's a great episode.
Really?
Are you guys gonna keep doing armchair analysis? Or what's it called? Is that what it's called, armchair analysis?
Possibly, yeah.
Since you already like completed both of us. Since
yeah, no, it was two of a two-part series.
You figured both of us out.
Didn't take long.
Yeah.
I feel like we should dive in on certain things. So the armchair analysis has to be about something that happened in one of the videos or something like that, and we do a deeper dive.
Okay.
Good idea.
And then the week after, we're going to be reviewing Frenching the Creep episode 1.
Interesting. Snake eating its own tail. Okay, good.
And then Quarantine Classics on Saturday, we have the toe-tapping tournament. And we had a lot of fun last week with that. And this week, we're gonna Nick, you're taking command of this particular
bracket.
Yes,
it's going to be all music, our best and catchiest music from VHS tapes, not from commercial jingles, but from VHS tapes. And they're going to be going head-to-head, and we'll have a celebrity guest judge to help us decide which one comes out on top of my bracket. I mean, this is March Madness in May, so we're excited for that.
We're starving for sports right now, and we're providing it on Quarantine Classics. All right, anything else? You guys got anything else?
That's all I've got. Stay tuned, though. Stay till the end for Jonathan and Tim, is it?
I was just going to introduce this. Jonathan and Tim, two brothers from Phoenix. I'm their biggest fan, and I was like, where can I get your music? And they're like, we haven't put out any music. But they're just like these two talented dudes who put out stuff just for us. And they should be making millions of dollars doing something else, but instead they're sending it to us. But I love it. Keep sending it to us. This one, they mixed a Roller Coaster. You remember Dave Belmont's talent show from Minnesota last week? He took the Roller Coaster song and they took the Rubik's Cube song. They called it Rubik's Coaster. And it's genuinely a great song. And they did all the video for it too. These guys are fucking talented. So we're going to leave you all on that. And if we had been prepared, we could have done better. And that's all. That's it.
And we'll be right back right after that.
Rocks are done. Got to sleep. Bye.
And now, without further ado, the one, the only, Red Lightning.
Dr. Selner will complete the bunion surgery.
Yes, those are his pajamas he's wearing.
All right, I gotta go.
That's all. That's it.
Let me see that one.
Rocks are done. Gotta sleep. Bye.
That's it. That it had done.
We did our best. If we'd been prepared, we could have done better.
What do you think about Bibra?
About what?
My nose isn't for yuck anymore.
That's all I'm doing.
We'll be right back right after that.